today. I'm delighted to be talking to Rocky Shades and Rocky, say hello to everybody. Tell them how you're doing.
Hello, viewers. I'm very, very fine. And it's not really the south of France.
Rocky, you recently headlined the Cloven Hoof stage at Call of the Wild.
Yes.
How did that feel?
It was really good. What a great festival. I think I'd go next year, actually.
Brilliant.
Yeah, I've heard Black Rain are on next year. I would actually pay to see them. But joking aside, I thought it was really, really cool. The whole day was really cool. Except it wasn't really hot. But you know what's that?
You were actually my favourite band. You were the most fun band there, and I really enjoyed it. So I do hope that you come back next year.
Funny enough. Right. Seagulls and Wind, worst enemies. We was my favourite band on the day as well. No, I can see what you're saying. It was fun, and I thought the boys did be great that day. And we were almost sober.
Now, I also saw a great performance of you as Wildside Riot. Now you're back to Rocky Shades Wrathchild.
That's the one.
Tell us about that. Give us the background, bring us up to speed.
Or have you got a couple of days? Right, bring up to speed. Rocky Shades Wrathchild. When we were Wildside Riot, we were putting a lot of Wrathchild songs in the set. And you know, it's like with people, they're never appeased by what you put in the set. It's always what you don't put in the set. So basically, the fans decided we should play more Wrathchild stuff. I love the Wrathchild songs. The Wrathchild songs are very special to me. So we decided to put a version of the band together that would literally profile older Wrathchild songs. And we even put a poll on the internet to decide which songs we were doing. Never paid any attention to it. We played whatever we like, but you know, we did put the poll up there. Yeah, just let you know. It wasn't fake. And we were surprised that the unobvious songs that were selected in the list. Yeah, like we'd have the obvious, you know, Trash Queen, Kick Down the Wall, Stack Attack.
All the favourites.
But then all of a sudden, stuff from Delirium, you know, Do What You Wanna.
Oh, yeah.
And Good Girls Do It For Me. And all of a sudden, I thought, we've got a good set here. And because the band wanted to go out as a Wrathchild rather than AN for the band.
Uh-huh.
We thought it was a really good idea. Plus, so, I paid for the trademark anyway, but the Rocky Shades Wrathchild, why not use it?
And so who's in the band now?
Now, here's the rub. Because Wildside Riot are the best bunch of musicians I've ever worked with. Why don't you look at them with you?
Both.
Okay. I see, I can't see you, but I can see her. Can you see the appeal? Really? Okay. We'll share it then. Wildside Riot, best bunch of musicians I ever worked with. And great friends, really great friends. It's a no-brainer. I could have put a new version of the band together and tried to make it like the old Wrathchild, but Wildside Riot were Wrathchild fans. They were Rocky Shades fans. So why not put a band together where we'd all sort of get on, and that's how it came about. But rather than it be a dictatorship, like certain bands I'm not allowed to mention due to legal reasons, which we all know anyway, I thought, why not let the band dictate what the band do? Let the asshole lead vocalist learn his place and just be told what to do for a channel session. Yes, get chauffeur driven, yes, get the beers put in front of you, but the band needs to call the shot. And that's how Rocky Shades Wrathchild came about. Now, one thing I will say is, unfortunately for us, a guitarist, he only played one real show with Wildside Riot, and he blew me away with his writing skills as well as his playing skills. So I always earmarked him for something a bit more special.
Okay.
So when people say, like, oh, you're just using the Wildside Riot guitarist, he only did one gig, and then I owned him. He was mine. No, he's Mrs. Abraham, something to say about that, but I'm going to.
You're one of the best frontmen.
What's that, question one?
You're one of the best frontmen with an attitude to rule the world. Who influenced you when you were sitting there with your hairbrush in your bedroom when you were 10.
No contest. David Lee Roth, the Diamond Dave, the best front man that ever was, ever. Before I discovered Dave though, because bear in mind, we in England did not discover Van Halen until 1977.
Right, yeah.
It was Paul Stanley and Dee Snider.
Okay.
So I'm a hybrid of Paul Stanley and Dee Snider and David Lee Roth, and there was a smidgen of Alice Cooper in there.
Okay, yeah. Alright. And if you did a Desert Island Discs and you had to pick three songs, if you're only allowed three songs in the whole world, what would you choose?
That's a really difficult question, because funny enough, I asked myself this the other day, which is really silly because asking yourself questions is just mental. And I decided that rather than just have three songs, I'd just take the Girl Wasted Youth album.
Okay.
You know, I just love Girl Wasted Youth.
Oh, I love Girl too. No,
yeah,
but Phil.
She agreed. Absolutely amazing album, but everybody knows this. Nobody really, really understands that Wasted Youth is just one album. I'll play that forever.
Phil's been on this program.
Oh, hello, Phil.
Yeah,
most gorgeous man like ever.
Oh, that's so nice. You might even see this on Facebook, I suppose.
Hello, Phil. Wasted Youth, my all-time favourite album. I saw you support Kiss as well. I think it was 1980. That's going back a bit.
Glam punk, for me, it's got everything. It's got the glamour of Sweet's wigwam bam. It's got the attitude of punk, and it's got the big riffs and the guitar solos of hard rock. So it's a fantastic genre to be in, would you agree?
Definitely, but glam punk sort of originated from the glam metal idea. Despite the people that think they own the glam metal idea, which I won't name because everybody's read their interviews, the glam metal idea was evolution. I loved the glitz and glam of glam.
Yeah.
I also loved the kick in the gulag attitude of metal. But let's face it, a lot of metal bands weren't pretty. A lot of metal bands were like damn ugly. Not all of them, I'm not labelling all of them, but a lot of them are like, no, seriously, you were not born under the glam sign. So when I sort of fused with my evolution, glam with metal, to form, hey, get this, glam metal, gets better. It was a no-brainer. You know, everybody then thought, yeah, we love metal, we love glam. But we don't particularly want to look like, you know, the Sweet in Coco or Papa Joe looking, you know, Little Willy sort of thing.
We want to look hard.
We want to look glam enough. We want our lipstick to really slam the message home. Right, kids?
So what do you remember about the early 80s scene?
Oh my God. Everything was big. Everything was big in excess. And anyone that can remember anything about the 80s, well, obviously wasn't there, they just read about it. Well, I remember about the 80s, and this came in, it's sort of like the Second World War. You read about the battles in the Second World War, and you say, this all went on at the same time? Well, that was like the 80s. You look at the big hair, you look at the big clothes, and then you look at the metal side of things, you look at the political side of things, and it's all going on at the same time.
Yeah.
Yet, when you look into history, you could almost compartmentalise.
Compartmentalise.
Why did I even attempt that? Seriously, why did I even attempt that? Compartmentalise all the little individual elements.
Yeah, I agree with you, and whereas when you're living it, you're just getting on with it, and you just always take it for granted, actually. But the press about you in the 80s was hilarious. I mean, what happened to the edible knickers, the whipped cream, and the new Nouvelle Maidens?
I still like whipped cream. I still like whipped cream, but according to like new laws and rules and stuff, it's now apparently illegal to rub whipped cream on your lady's dress.
In public. It's probably okay in private.
Well, it is.
Well, you've got to get them to agree first.
Kiss and tell, you think.
I think that's the key.
Kiss and tell. Kiss and tell. You do it. and then they regret it, and then the next thing you know, you're being banged up. So it's better not to do it in the first place. But not many people know the Scrape Cream started off with you know, when Kiss started doing the blood thing, and Wasp started doing the blood thing, they started using a number of different stuffs, inverted commas, because they weren't quite sure which was the best stuff. I've been there, seen it, done it. Now, when I first did the spray cream thing, it wasn't spray cream, it was yoghurt.
Oh.
And unfortunately, when yoghurt gets into the crevices of your leather gloves, it starts smelling like dead people.
I can imagine. Ooh.
And you're on stage strutting your stuff, pointing and doing what people do.
I'm wondering why no one wants
smelling
to
of
be
dead
your
people.
Friend.
And wondering why nobody wants to come remotely close. And you're thinking, I'm not quite sure this is working. But yeah, when it comes to like the blood thing as well, and even things like what we set on fire, we experimented with everything. And I remember.
And that's quite dangerous with the hairdos, yeah?
Well, yeah. We also discovered, and don't try this at home, kids, but we discovered that what you get together in the small confines of a kitchen does not equate to a stage and lots of rushing of air. I actually got the flame on the flaming axe to be quite controlled in the kitchen. Unfortunately, when we did it live, which was November the 29th, 1980.
Okay. Wow,
do you remember? The air hit the axe fuel and suddenly I got Inferno on a stick. And it didn't seem so cool, but it was cool when the roadies hit me with about 6 fire extinguishers.
Did you set your hair alight?
No!
Oh,
how
yes!
Brilliant was that?
Excellent!
Didn't damage any stage gear, didn't ruin any hair, but apparently we used all the fire extinguishers and I had to rethink the fire situation after that.
Did it cost you? For the extinguishers.
Ah, no, they just couldn't wait to get out of the building.
Bargain. It was quite a coup to have Bruce Dickinson produce and star in the video for Nana Nuclear Rocket. What was he like to work with?
Brilliant. I love that man. I knew Bruce when he was Bruce in Samson.
Yeah.
And we used to go partying at his girlfriend's flat in Lucia, above a hairdresser's. And I remember the day that the idea was put to him about doing the video. We was doing a make-believe party show for MTV.
Okay.
These things don't always, like, they're always real. You don't get real drinks or real scenarios. Now this is a real sea, real boats that don't appear, real seagulls that don't do anything.
Real noisy waves.
Real noisy people that keep coming in and out and have to be shooed away. Real burnt kneecaps. What was the question? Anyway.
What would you like to work
no,
with?
No, anyway. We were doing this thing and we decided there's no drink involved. And Tiger Tales were on the same gig. You know, they were on the same interview, so they were in the same boat, but they decided to stay and we decided to go ship and walk just down the road. They were serving real beer and doing real
things in Wardour Street. Okay.
And Rathchild bass player at the time, probably one of the only deep good things he's ever done, was say to Bruce very cheekily, I know you just started your own video company, why don't you film our next single? Me at this point, I'm hoping the ground would have opened up, so I'm feeling very embarrassed. You know, how do you approach the great, you know, golden god of rock, Bruce Dickinson, and say, come and film our video? And he goes, what a bloody great idea.
Oh, fantastic.
But then, he starts with some storylines where I get messed up. And I don't mind being, I mean, Nuclear Rocket video, I had a 50-pound in weight rocket motor attached to my back and roller skates. I could do that sort of shit, but when he started talking about throwing food at me, you know, oh no, oh no, God bless her. Come on back.
When I see young bands dressed like Nirvana, I long for the time when rock stars look like rock stars, and Rathchild brings that back, I think, a little bit for people, so that's a fantastic thing to do on stage.
The thing about bringing image back is you don't bring it back, you've got to have it to start with.
Yeah,
it's
right.
Like, take any member of my fan, like I say, my amazing bass player, who's also the bass player of New Gen Superstars. That's not a plug, by the way. That's
Johnny
just fact.
Suicide.
Johnny Suicide and Gaz, my drummer, are currently in New Gen Superstars, and they look as cool as that all the time. I must confess, I only look like this at least 23 of every 24 hours.
What happens in the last hour?
Oh, it always departs. Oh, the makeup dries up, the shoe extensions, the razor up starting to hurt. And
where did the man get all their wild stage gear back in the day?
Oh, God. You had to make it. You literally had to make it. One of Rathchild's biggest sort of features that everybody remembers is the fact that we were the Blue Peter of the rock world. And people think it's because we wanted to do that, but it was basically because you had to do that. There was no internet. Yes, there was no internet. People were only learning to bang rocks together and create fire. You know what I'm saying? There was no internet. You had to make stuff. And basically, if you didn't make it, it didn't exist.
And you still look great. You still make your own shit.
We still make our own shit.
Okay.
Me more than most. Me more than most, because I've got the most patience. I once sewed, and this is not rock and roll in any shape or form, I once sewed physically 256,000 sequins onto a coat. Oh yeah! Yeah!
That's fantastic. I actually, Bullets and Octane do that too, so what I'm finding out is that in the world of rock and roll, they're actually the best seamstresses as well, all these rockers.
Well, I thought I was a bloody great seamstress until I met my fiancée, and now I've met my match.
She makes stuff for you.
She sews stuff on things for me.
Oh, brilliant.
I've got a really nice jacket which has rocker patches on. But unfortunately, every time you wear a jacket with rocker patches on, no matter what it says, and mine actually said something like miniskirt, so I was very threatening. And I've since learned that miniskirt club is actually a female biker gang in America.
Oh, right. You probably get your nads taken off for wearing that.
I was once threatened to be killed for wearing that.
Oh, really?
In Cardiff.
Right,
so
okay.
I took the rocker patches off and put my name on instead, and now I don't get bothered at all. My fiance sewed those letters on.
Okay, brilliant.
But I was going to wear it today, but it's too hot. It's far too hot. I have to come back again. You have to watch it some other time.
And what's the secret of keeping the look and, you know, keeping rock and roll in your soul?
You've got to be rock and roll in your soul.
Authenticity.
Yeah. How many people have lost the will to do this, but still want to be seen as doing this? You know, I do this because I want to do this. You know, I've actually got a day job. And before people write in and tell me what it is, I know what it is. So up yours. Now, because I've got a day job, it's quite easy to say, oh, I'm a bit old for this now. I can't do this now. Or I look in the mirror and I think, now come on, there's a few more years left in you. It's
absolutely
like when you've got a really decent pair of tyres and you say, now come on, we've got a few more miles left in you, motherfuckers.
And when you can come into a festival like Call of the Wild and rule it, you know, I mean, why would you hang up your coat and your cowboy hat?
Well, I've always said, and we're going a bit serious now, I've always said that if I become embarrassing and people actually think I'm becoming embarrassing, then I will hang up the glitter jockstrap.
Well, Susie Quattro, I interviewed her and she said she's going to do it when no one whistles in her ass. So you could all see.
Okay. I didn't know you were whistling at my ass. Very sexist behaviour.
Okay. And Rathchild always seemed to be getting in trouble.
Understatement.
So do you have some fun stories about that?
Have you got a couple of weeks? Yeah, well, the thing with Rathchild was, bands today that use any special effects, are usually under some sort of control. You know, everything's like safe. That's a really good word to use because they're not going to cause any damage because everything's been checked, everything's been wired up properly. And the Rathchild were anything but safe. We used to turn pyrotechnics into ultra pyrotechnics by seeing what we could add to it to make it do stuff. I remember once using an outdoor 150-foot jerk indoors with a 10-foot ceiling just to see what you can do. Now, come on, think about it. 150 foot, it's 10 foot, where's it going to go?
I mean, health and safety wasn't even really in the vocab in killed the 80s.
This brings me to the point we raised earlier on when we were trying to get rid of people off the balcony. You said that it took me a long time to fire the bazooka at Call of the Wild. Now, the bazooka's not allowed. Now, the bazooka's not allowed to have any electronic stuff or anything that can cause any fire whatsoever. So yeah. All the bazooka does now is hold an handheld confetti cannon, which needs twisting while it's in its frame. And the time it takes to twist and get the stuff out is just not necessarily when you want it to happen. Simple as that.
Yeah, I did notice that a little bit, but it was all a happy ending when it actually happened, so...
It's always a happy ending. Always get a happy ending, never an unhappy ending.
But I guess the lawsuits that you've had, I mean, lawsuits were a big part of the Rothschild story, fights with the labels, the fights with the other members, the fights with other bands called Rothschild in America, I mean, that was a bit of a less fun side of the story.
Yeah, the fight began with our record label. Was the label was run by a guy who was quite young at the time, got a bit of money in the bank, thought it was quite an insult that we should even want to leave this label. So it was obviously going to put that flag firmly in the ground. I think one of the figures that was quoted to us to leave that record label to go to RCA America was 1/3 million. So yeah, I just sold the band. I just sold their internal organs for them.
Okay, well, anyway, listen, all good things come to an end, so I need to cover the basics.
Well, just be good.
Any live dates coming up?
Well, we've obviously got the Hard Rock Hell Sleeve.
Yeah.
Which I do believe we're on the 31st of August, which is the Saturday.
I'll be reviewing them first.
And we're third top on the bill.
Hey.
Which actually means people know who we are.
Yeah, brilliant.
Joking aside, it's going to be a really good day. The lineup for that show, if we hadn't have been on it, we'd have been there. It's that good.
Okay, and any music planned?
Oh yeah, we're working on new stuff. Other live dates we're working on. I wanted to get Hard Rock Hell out of the way first.
Okay.
Before we think about other dates. I don't want to do the toilet circuit. Been there, seen it, done it. Don't want to play everywhere and everywhere. I want to handpick a few dates, you know, maybe some places that like us, maybe some places that don't.
It's always more fun, I would have thought, for Rothschild.
Oh, Southern England. I only come to watch me anyway.
And finally, where should people go if they want to find out more?
Well, I don't know, Facebook, Instagram, grandmas, anyone older than... Anyone older than 40?
All the cool people over 40.
It'll all be advertised. It'll all be advertised on the internet. I won't do it because I'm too cool for that sort of shit.
Thank you so much for making some time to talk to us.
It's been a real pleasure. We've only had 3 hours practicing for this.